First, I gotta make a note to myself to look over what this thing is, so I can send it to y'all later. Because I have no clue. Just write a D record about lung cancer.
Yes, question number two.
Okay. All right, I'll look at that. So I'll send something back out once I look at it and actually probably call her. And then I'll send you something back on the announcement.
Because you know how we are, we freak out.
Yes, I understand completely. But I'll find that out. Especially for those number ones, right? Y'all gotta know it pretty early. All right, so a couple of things about the schedule. I have to do some traveling somewhere in here during this time. One of them is next week, so it doesn't really matter if y'all have schedule. But just kind of to look at your schedule, we're going to be here. We're going to finish up endo today in endocrinology. And then, because we did just diabetes last week, right? So we got to finish up the thyroid. Did we do adrenal and all that? We just did diabetes, right? So we'll finish up on endo today and start on neuro. Then on the 20th, you will have I'm going to put up an online quiz, which is going to be an adaptive quizzing. But you're going to come to class because Tuesday you won't be here. So we're going to finish up neuro on Tuesday. On Monday the 20th. You'll be off on Tuesday the 21st. So that'll be your study day for the exam, which is going to be endocrine and neuro. All right, so then your test is the morning of the 27th. Then this is the part, I still have to figure out some of the rest of it, because there's one day, the week of the 10th and the 11th. And it's not really stuff I can change because I'm doing expert witness stuff, so I can't tell the judge that, no, I got to change class. So I will let you know exactly what we're going to do. If it is going to be, because I'll still be able to lecture and get the content in, but I just have to figure out how I'm going to get your test done. That's the issue. Whether it's going to be something, I get a proctor who's going to come to your classroom, or to get it done in the test center. So that's the thing that's different. So that's why I have to figure out exactly what's happening that day. So the exam itself will still be on the 11th. I just have to figure out how, kind of thing. All right. So that's it for now. I don't think there's anything else I have to go back for yet. Hopefully, I don't have to get back. All right. So, quiz online next week on Monday. We still have class, so it'll be online. I'll probably put it up either before or after class so that you have the time, you know. Y'all want it before or after? I'll let you ask y'all. The majority of rules, because more of y'all in here.
After.
After?
Well, it depends
Right. Okay. So, I'll probably just open it up for that day. Because it's always adaptive quizzing anyway, so it's up to how y'all do. So I'll put that online, but we do have class that day, so we can finish up neuro. You'll have the 21st off to study and do stuff that you need to do. All right, and then we'll have the test on the 27th. And then, like I said, we'll do the content for the next section. And part of what you guys have already had the mental health portion out of the textbook for mental health. So what we're going to do for the mental health portion for this course this time is not going to be that. It'll actually just be content related to those things that are in your Lewis book. Because Lewis also has some things on substance abuse and all that kind of stuff. So it's not going to be out of a separate book. It'll just be out of Lewis. But I'll give you those specific chapters and that kind of thing for that. Because I was looking at that the other day. Instead of having somebody kind of come in here and recycle again. So as far as everything else goes, the schedule is going to stay the same. Unless I hear something about I have to go back or that kind of thing. So hopefully I will not. but we shall see.
Okay.
All right. The handouts that I gave you, there's a book that I really like about mid-surge concepts. I really, really like it. And so that's what all those pages are, because it's about the neural stuff, where you see how it says the first do things, just things you do first. That's the one that has like 11 pages together. So that's like the, kind of gives you a, almost like the concept map you use to get ready for your exam. The other one, the 164 and 165, is the review that's from the HISI NCLEX review book about strokes. The stroke is actually going to be in this test. And then the appendix is from a review book from the review course itself that actually talks about the differences between Parkinson's, myasthenia, and MS, just so you kind of get an idea about some of the, because when you read the neuro stuff, some, a lot of them sound the same when you're reading them, so it kind of gives you a little comparison chart so you can kind of see the little nuances that are different between them. But also in that review stuff that I gave you, the one with the 11 pages, it has some of those diseases, because it has Parkinson's in there. It has myasthenia in there, has MS, just so you have some kind of other resources to kind of look at for the major content. Because, of course, when you're looking at the endocrine side, as far as you know how y'all are testing purposes wise, diabetes is going to be on there, so you need to know diabetes. The next disease process that happens most often in endocrine is going to be thyroid problems. Adrenal stuff happens, but most of the time we cause it. When we have patients that have Cushing's syndrome, not the disease itself, but the syndrome itself. So that's the hierarchy when you're thinking about the endocrine side. On the neuro side, your gut strokes are very common, so that's something that you're going to see. So you need to make sure you know those. You kind of, the myasthenia gravis and the Guillain-Barré and all those, they happen, but they don't happen as much as a person having a stroke. So that's a major piece of the neural side. So we're going to look at all of those things, but those, when you're talking about looking at what I need to know for big time stuff, stroke is going to be the one, of course, that you need to look at for that. We also have seizures under there, Alzheimer's, Bell's palsy, you know, all that kind of stuff that's in there. Headaches are in there, which is about my life kind of thing. But there are some things that happen more than others, so stroke is a big one that we're going to see in there. All right. So last week we left off on endocrine stuff, and we talked about diabetes. So remember to make sure you know what's considered diagnostic for diabetes. That's going to be a fasting glucose of 126 or greater. Remember, that's always repeated. A random glucose of 200 or greater, and then a person who has the symptoms of polyuria, polydipsia, polyphagia, with that glucose that is that high. Because your glucose truly should never be that high, even if you eat 5 candy bars. Your body's going to produce insulin to cover that. And that's the thing, that having a glucose that high is what's considered diagnostic. Think about what things you have to do as far as managing your patient, because that's what's important for them to understand what they do on sick days, how do they manage their disease as far as diet, exercise, knowing about the major medications, sulfonylureas, okay, that was one you had to know about, insulins, because those are common drugs we give to patients, and the insulin sensitizer drug category. So those were the major ones you needed to know. Because remember, I told you there's a lot of different categories we use, because what we do is keep adding them on as patients still fail as far as maintaining glycemic control. So those are the major ones. So you should know when your insulin peaks, when you need to monitor your patient for hypoglycemia, because those are things that you need to know in your practice as working with a nurse. You need to know that when I give this person a log insulin, when do I have to worry about hypoglycemia? Versus if I just, why do I need to worry about it? You know, if you have a person that's having hypoglycemic symptoms 5 minutes after you gave a regular insulin, then you know it's not really the insulin that's the problem, it's something else. So that's why you have to kind of think about how you're deciphering that in a question when you get a patient or you're talking about pathology with a person. So that's what I mean about knowing those things. Knowing how they need to manage if they do have an episode of hypoglycemia, that they're going to get 15 grams carbohydrate, and then once their glucose goes up, then you have to give them protein. Because remember, sugar's going to raise you up, but you got to give something for the long haul, especially for people who take oral agents, because oral agents are micronized to be delivered over time. So what happens to a person when you give those is that, yeah, I deal with hypoglycemia now, but I may have to deal with it for hours and hours because the medication is still working. So that's especially important for people who have renal disease because they hold on to it a lot longer. It's micronized to be delivered over time, but that's a normal body that's going to excrete it. Kidney disease holds on to it longer. So that's why sometimes you'll even see, or you may have seen, that sometimes you're only giving patients their diabetic meds every other day. That's because they hold on to them so long. So those are kind of things you got to make sure you understand about diabetes. So now we're going to get into some of the other endocrine disorders that we're going to talk about. And the first one we're going to talk about is thyroid disorders. And now you know everything was kind of like we did with patients who had electrolyte disorders. Everything is hypo or hyper, you know, hyperkalemia or hypokalemia. So the same kind of thing we're talking about. Endocrine dysfunction, you either have too little of a hormone being produced or too much. So the target organ or the target tissue or something that's involved with it is gonna show symptoms of what's happening with your patient. And generally, when you're talking about things happening with people, this thyroid is one that has to do, if you think about metabolic issues that are going on with the body, it does other stuff too. But it's mainly thing that is going to control metabolic activity. So this is one that when you see people have problems, they're usually feeling like a slug, or they're feeling like the Energizer Bunny. That's usually what people are telling you when they come see you and you're evaluating them to see what's going on. So the first side, of course, we're going to look at hypothyroidism. So that's going to be a patient who has decreased circulation of thyroid hormone. But what generally happens with this as well is that you're going to have a high TSH, or thyroid stimulating hormone, because you're not producing enough hormone. The thyroid stimulating hormone says, hey, Sharon, work a little better, work a little harder. So TSH is really high, but you don't get the corresponding increase in the T3, T4. So that's what happens with your patient. So thyroid hormones, T3, T4 are low. TSH is going to be high because it's trying to get you to stimulate and make more, but you're not doing that. So think about everything in your body being slow. That's what happens when a patient is hypothyroid. They tend to be cold all the time. When you tell them, how do you feel? They feel cold. Oh my God, everything is freezing to me. I wish I had that because I'm always hot. All right, so it's like, oh, slow everything down. That's the only good thing about it is being cold. Other than that, everything else is bad when you talk about hypothyroid, because the patient gains weight even if they don't eat. So that's what generally brings the person to see you in the office, is that they feel so tired, I can't do anything, I just feel like a slug. I only eat a little bit, and I'm eating less than I ever ate before in my life, but I'm still gaining weight. Because that's usually what's happened to the person, is that no matter what they're doing, they just feel really tired. They have weight gain. They also can have, that's okay, bradycardia. All the stuff that kind of goes with everything going really slow, this person can have. Slow through the GI tract means constipation. So all of those things are going on. Think about everything in the body is slowing down. This is why the person feels like they're just are going nowhere. They're tired. They can't think. All these things are going on with the patient. So that's what generally brings them to see you. Now, anytime you have issues with thyroid disease, they tend to happen more in women. It's just the nature of the beast. It's also an autoimmune disorder, so what you'll also see is that you'll see a cluster of autoimmune diseases together. So if a patient has, how many of your patients you notice who are diabetic also take pills for their thyroid? Because they're both autoimmune disorders. So you'll see that a lot when you see patients actually have this problem. So everything is slow. Doctor's going to bring the patient in, do lab work on the patient first. So you're going to do that thyroid profile so you can see how the thyroid hormones are. They also, especially because it's women, they do actually a lot of times do our FSH and LH to try to see if we're going through menopause, all that kind of stuff going on. Because there's always different things that are going on why that's happening. Some doctors will also add in drug screening because you know people do take medication to keep them sedate, so we don't know whether it's medication associated with that. But that's the first kind of thing you do, is lab work on this person. If it can, you also do a physical exam, because you're seeing whether or not this person, sometimes they will have edema associated with it. They may also have a goiter, because the other thing that the thyroid does is I need to get bigger in order to produce more hormones, so that's why it sometimes happens. So you may see a visible goiter, or you can actually palpate it when you are doing the examination on a patient. Everybody in here has had a thyroid exam, because if you ever go to the doctor for a physical, that's when they get you to drink some water and have you swallow and stand behind you and feel as you swallow. What happens is thyroid actually sits around the trachea, and when you swallow, it actually moves up and down. So there's what it'll do is it moves under your fingertips, and you just feel it move up and down, and you're feeling for the contours and the size. So that's what's going on when you're checking for that indication. So what they do is, once I see that yes, this is what's going on, you may also see a doctor do antibodies, thyroid antibodies on the patient, because sometimes they're trying to figure out which autoimmune disease is actually happening to the thyroid itself. So once they do that, figure out that this is going on, you may actually also see sonograms done, so I can actually visualize the thyroid. If they see nodules, then they do biopsies associated with that. Biopsies will tell you whether or not there's something cancerous there. Also, when they're doing the thyroid scans, they can also tell you whether something is, when they look at nodules, they tell whether they're cold or hot. Cold usually means cancer, that's the bad part. Anything that's hot tends to be inflammatory, so that's infectious. So if you had to have a nodule that was there, having one that is hot is a good thing. Cold nodules, they always investigate to see whether or not there's a cancer there. Not always that there is cancer, but that's what it's suspicious for. So once that happens and we figure out all that's going on with the patient, the physical changes that are happening, because you get, as the person gains weight, all that kind of stuff is going on. One of the things you have to do when you explain how therapy is going to go is that, yes, I'm going to give you medication, but just like it took you a while to gain weight and feel bad, it also takes you a while to feel better. And so patients need to know that even though I'm giving you hormone, it does not fix it right away. Generally, it takes about, patient starts to feel better in about 2 weeks. Physical changes may take months. So that's what patients need to understand, that it's not going to go away just because you start to feel better. It's going to take a little while for that to happen. So doctors start you out on thyroid replacement. With thyroid replacement, there's a formula that doctors use and look at body mass index and how much they want to give you, that kind of thing. But they will start it out low, and then based on your symptoms, if you're feeling better, what your levels are as far as your medication or hormone levels are, then they'll change your therapy. But it's never going to be something you change like every 2 weeks. Usually thyroid therapy is changed every month. So if a person starts to feel it, they want to see whether or not you feel it, because if you give you too much, you can put you on the other side. So what they're going to do is actually see if your TSH is going down. It's a downward trend when you're looking at the values. If your T3, T4s are going up for the patient, and then based on that, if they're still not getting better, the next month they're going to change your therapy, and then the next month they'll change your therapy. Usually the person is okay. Most people usually have found their dose they're going to need by about the second month. But if it's not, they continue to do that. And then if, generally, if you're pretty stable and everything is getting better, you're starting to lose weight, you're starting to feel better, you have more energy, those types of things, then you usually go into where you're going into every 3 months to actually get lab work, testing, as far as seeing if you're feeling better, those types of things. Once a person is stable, patients may end up going to the doctor every 6 months to a year. It all depends on the patient. But most endocrinologists see you a minimum of every 6 months. Yeah, you have something going on. But that is after you're stabilized, after you're doing better. The other thing is that, this, especially for women who have this of childbearing age, there's issues with fertility, those types of things during that particular time. So sometimes that is something that will actually send a woman to get testing in the first place, because even though she's doing stuff great that she wants to do because she wants to have a baby, there's also impact with thyroid for that as well as far as fertility goes. So once you actually start this, one of the big things when you give a patient Synthroid or Armour Thyroid, whichever supplement you're going to give the patient for treating them, the one thing to always remember is what a patient starts on is what they stay on. And that's mainly because the bioavailability of the medication is not the same. So if you have somebody who takes Synthroid and you have somebody that takes Levoxyl, even though categorically they're the same drug, and if you look at them, it says it's the same medicine, it will not be treated the same by the body for every patient. So whatever you start a person, I'm not saying a person can't take a generic, but if you are on a generic, you stay on a generic. If you're on brand, you stay on brand. If you're on armor thyroid, that's all you take. And that's the way it has to be with that medication. Because what they're doing is basing your values on how that medication works for you. So it's not real. A lot of times in the hospital, how we always use generics for stuff is really not great for thyroid patients. It is really not. The other thing about thyroid meds is that they should be taken on an empty stomach at least 30 minutes to an hour before you take any other drugs. So if you're if you have other medications to take, thyroid should be a single dose medication early in the morning. The reason you take it early in the morning is if you have a person that is getting on the hyperthyroid side, you want to see where it's happening. And that's why you give it early in the morning. Part of that is because when you have a person that's heart starts racing, all this kind of stuff, you want to see if it's actually that drug or something else that's going on. So single dose, early AM, at least 45 minutes to an hour before you take anything else. And then we actually change the medication, or if you're going to get lab work, that kind of thing, you always make sure the patient does not take their medication before they get their labs done. And you try to get them to get labs to check it early AM. Because they really need to take the medication. But this one, if you think slug, that's how the person feels. When you have a person that has hyperthyroid, this is a person that usually does not come to see you. Okay, and that's because everything is speeded up. Okay, this is a person who has a high heart rate, high blood pressure, all this kind of stuff going on, but they usually don't complain about that. And usually when they do come in to see you, it's late in the process, and it's because that's been going on for a while that no longer do you just have a high heart rate, you have palpitations. Or you feel like your heart is going to beat out of your chest. That's one of the things they come to see you with. The other one is exophthalmos. That's the person that looks surprised all the time. That's when they usually come see you. But generally, this is metabolic stuff going on. So everything speeds up. This person is losing weight no matter how much they eat. They have all this free energy. They need very little sleep. They have diarrhea because everything through the GI tract is fast. They have flight of ideas because some patients with hyperthyroid present with mania. That's how bad it can be for some patients. So everything speeds up. Flight of ideas, all that kind of stuff that goes with the crazy piece can be there. But generally, they have so much, they're doing everything, and they just love it because they're able to do everything and only need 3 hours sleep. So that's what usually happens. And since it happens more to women, do you think they worry about it? Because they're like, I get everything done. And I can eat like a cow and lose weight. That's the major thing. That they start. I can eat everything I want and not even worry about it. Don't gain an ounce. Because you can have a person who truly can lose 40 pounds in a month. That's the most I've ever seen when I was working in the office. 40 pounds in a month, and you're going like, what? And they tell you how much they eat, you're going like, really, I hate you so much right now, kind of thing, because that's just what happens. So everything speeds up. So heart rate is faster, blood pressure is higher. Those are the dangerous things, but they don't really see that. All they see is I'm losing weight, I look fantastic, all my clothes fit, I have all this energy to work, I only need 2 hours sleep. They're in the middle of the night, you know, vacuuming the floor, washing clothes. That's how you pick it up, because normal people don't do that. Unless that's just the time you wash your clothes and vacuum your house. But everybody really doesn't do that. So what generally happens, of course, they come in. Some of them actually may have a heart attack. They have arrhythmias going on. They have chest pain, those types of things, or the exophthalmos. That's what usually brings them to you. So what we have to do is one of the few times in medicine that we use medication at a high dose. Remember I told you there's only a few times. Cancer was one. Anytime you have anything inflammatory, and then thyroid is the third one. Because I got to get those hormones under control. I have to do something to bind them, or I have to take a medication to stop them from replicating. Okay. You also sometimes have to give the patient, of course, because of the issue with blood pressure, you have to put them on blood pressure meds. And the drug of choice is usually going to be a beta blocker, mainly because not only does it control the heart rate, can lower their blood pressure, but a lot of times your patients have tremors. And so it helps to control all three of those at one time. So you know when you're talking about compliance of medication, that's what you want to do is put a patient on something that will control all things that are going on with them. As much as you can, because that's what helps. So beta blockers help to kind of deal with all of those things that are going on. But then you're going to give them medications that actually are going to bind with the thyroid hormones. So Tapazole is one of those medications we can use for that with the patient. But what you're going to do is actually they're going to get that at a high dose first, but you have to monitor them even closer than you do for the patient who is hypothyroid. Mainly because if you bind it so quickly and then the person responds to it really fast, you can send them into hypothyroidism. So what you have to do, they're probably for that first few weeks, they're actually monitored every 2 to 3 weeks. Not a month. You don't wait a whole month before you see this patient again. Okay, so they're going to start at high doses on their medication. Then you're going to start to lower it down based on their symptomatology. Okay, because sometimes you'll have a person taking they'll take the medication several times a day, down to a person who only takes it once a day. So it will all depend on how those numbers are for that patient. So you actually look at what their levels are on their T3, T4, their TSH. Now these patients also may have a goiter as well. This one is in response to all the hormone they're producing. So you can have goiter on both sides, whether the person is hypo or hyperthyroid. Okay? So the same kind of testing is done, scanning, that kind of stuff. Thyroid hormones are going to do that for the patient. They also do antibody testing. If there's nodules there, they see if anything's going on with the patient, because thyroid cancer is one of those things sometimes that may be associated with this as well. Okay, so once they do figure out all that's going on, that's done with the patient, they're going to give them the antithyroid drugs. You may also see something that sounds kind of weird, and this is because, you know, that we use iodine to actually synthesize thyroid hormones. But sometimes they will give it to a patient when they have a goiter that's really large, and what it does is decrease the vascularity, so it decreases the amount of blood that's flowing through the goiter. And sometimes they'll do that, especially if they think they're going to have to do surgery on the patient. So it's radioactive iodine that they have to give to the patient, but that can actually help to, it's not going to make the goiter shrink a whole lot, but it does help it decrease in size, but they especially do that if the patient's going to have surgery to remove it. Because one of the things that happens from goiter, you know, when you have that, it can compress on your carotids. Patients can have syncope associated with it. That's what I was having. I didn't have hypothyroid, and I didn't have hypo, because if you looked at all my lab work, it was perfect. Had a lot of nodules, but every time I would raise my hand above my head, I would feel lightheaded and almost pass out. So when I'm putting groceries away in the house, that was problematic, because that's raising your hand above your head. So everybody's different about how they present with stuff, so just know that that is something that can happen with your patients.